another episode of the Disney Resorts Podcast. My name is Kenny Hayes, and I am joined alongside, as always, by the one, the only, Walt Ramirez.
Good evening, Ken. How are you tonight?
I'm doing very well, sir. I'm doing very well. It's just a couple days past Halloween now. How was your Halloween?
It was excellent. Excellent. You forgot something, though.
Uh-oh. What did I forget?
You forgot to take your mask off.
I was scary. Scary.
That was too easy. I had to use that.
That was easy. I like it. It's okay. I forgive you. You didn't apologize, though. So, folks, we have a great show lined up for you today. We got some Skyliner news, some updates coming in 2024. Fort Wilderness. Once again, we have another cabin update for you DVC members out there. Grand Floridian. The Gingerbread House is on its way for the 2024 holiday season. We'll give you an update on that. Geyser Point. Menu changes, some significant, some added, some removed. We'll get into that as well and much, much more. So, folks, before we begin, as always, if you're watching us over on YouTube, hit that subscribe button, give this video a thumbs up. If you're watching us, if you're listening to us over on the audio platforms, give us a 5-star review. Why? You know why, because you know you like us. So, Walt, what do you got for us today?
Well, let's see. One of our favorite
smorgasbord.
Yeah, we do. We have a nice buffet of things to talk about today. So the Skyliner will be closed January 16th through January 21st for maintenance, quote unquote maintenance. And then between Riviera and the International Gateway, it will be closed until the 27th, so an additional week. For those folks, that's interesting to me because I mean this. I understand that you know there's some minor things I guess that probably have to be tweaked and fixed because it is constantly running, or at least you know during the daylight time. And it's just I guess it's just an annual thing because I do remember last year around this time it was also closed down for a period of time.
You know, that would impact my stay because you and I are talking about a trip in January or February. So these dates would definitely impact where you and I, especially where you like to stay all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the Skyliner has become initially when it first started, I wasn't a huge fan. I don't know about you. I was kind of a little hesitant about it. And then the more I used it, I actually started to realize, you know, how efficient it is and how useful it is to get around without having to, you know, use your car and drive around and park. It became very, very convenient to get from, you know, the resorts that you and I stay at frequently. Like I, you know, if I'm staying at Beach Club or Caribbean Beach and you at Boardwalk, you can easily get around using the Skyliner. But like you said, I mean, if you're staying at Riviera, you're losing the Skyliner for the 2 weeks basically.
Yeah.
So if you're going
that's
in January,
that's tough to swallow.
That's tough to that's rough. I mean, listen, I you know, they say, well, but bus transportation, but I mean you and I know that's not the same.
No. Yeah. No. I don't like that self-infliction.
Yeah, that's not the same. So Skyliner has always been interesting to me because it's had its good moments and its bad moments. I know you had a story that you shared with our listeners a few months back where you and your wife had a little bit of an interesting experience on the Skyliner.
Oh yeah. I think it was my January trip.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it was your January trip.
That was stench.
Yeah. That was
fungus.
Once you start sharing, those
cabins.
Thank you. With that, with folks, it just gets a little too congested in there because realistically, those were made for just a group, one group of people. So whatever party you're in, you want to just go with your party. And then once you start putting in multiple parties in there, it kind of gets a little awkward because it's very tight quarters. So you're in there for quite a bit of time. So you know.
Depending on where you're going. Yes. And you make a good point, Walt, because generally I have noticed ever since the COVID protocols have gone away, as long as it's not busy however many are in your party, that's what they're going to put in there. They're not generally, I still have yet to see them cram you in if there's not a long line. But if you got park open, park close, or anything, you know, like a heavy midday flow, then you have a good chance of, you know, getting stuck with people you don't want to get stuck with. And you and I have had experiences. I mean, scratch and sniff was happening in my gondola and those vents weren't open.
Yeah, that's a rough situation for you and your wife.
They were rubbing each other's feet. God. Both of them.
You don't have to be that explicit. It sets up for an awkward situation, like you said, and it is, you know, it's a couple of minutes at least. I've never really sat and timed it between the time I get on and say, for example, at Epcot, and then, you know, the unload part of it. But, you know, pre-COVID and during COVID, it was nice to have that where they purposefully didn't load more than, you know, one group at a time in there.
Yes.
And it was nice because you could have a conversation. You know, you could talk about where you're going, what you're doing, anything.
Just kick your feet up and just enjoy the ride.
And enjoy the ride. And now you're in there with a group of people. You really may not want them to hear your business. So you're going to limit your conversation. You'll be staring at your phone for 2-3 minutes. And, you know, like you said, if you're in there with people that are kind of obnoxious, you know, it's not going to be a fun experience. So I wish that Disney would respect that a little more. And I get the whole, you know, the crowded thing, you know, especially like you said, at park close, like at Epcot, it gets backed up, busier times. I understand that. But, you know, that's one of those things where if you told people, I don't know about how you feel about this, but like if you told me that, okay, you'll get your own gondola, but you're going to have to wait like an extra 5-10 minutes, whatever.
I'd wait an extra 20 minutes.
Yeah, I'd be fine with that because, as you know, and I'm pretty sure you've had this experience in your years going to Disney where you've had to get on a bus and stand. I don't know if you've had that experience.
Yes, I have. Yeah, okay. Just like you think you're in the city and you're holding like the strap and the bar. Yeah. Yep.
Or you're on the monorail and you're standing. Mm-hmm. There's really no reason to cram that many people into it. First of all, it's a safety issue.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody,
especially when the monorail, the door's open.
Yeah, I mean, you could have, you know, you could have somebody lose their balance and fall on you. In Disney, you spend the majority of your time waiting online for things anyway. So
you do.
So what's an extra 5, 10, 15 minutes to wait for the next monorail so you can actually sit down, or wait for the next gondola to come along so you can actually sit and have your own gondola? So, you know, I've had some fun experiences on the Skyliner also with people where, you know, it's just, you'll get like a child maybe that doesn't, you know, decides that they're afraid and starts crying. Now you have a crying child for 2.5-3 minutes that, you know, you want to actually jump out of the gondola because you just don't want to deal with it. And it's just,
or they get up and they make it start swaying when you stopped.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That's not cool.
That, yeah. You can have that situation too. So, you know, but again, the Skyliner itself, you know, great form of transportation. It's endeared itself to me over time. And I would put it right up there with, you know, the monorail, if not surpassing the monorail, to be honest with you.
I agree with you. Now, let me ask you, Walt, while we're on the Skyliner real quick, have you ever, since its inception, have you ever, you or your wife, gone on her just to go for a Skyliner ride and come back?
I've thought about it. I have not. And I think in the future, on a future trip, whenever that might be, I may actually consider doing that.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I've wanted to, but I haven't, because most of the time when we go, we've spent we've spent a fortune on park passes. So we're kind of want to get on to the rides and get into the parks. There was a trip where I was doing more of a resort stay, and I thought about doing that, and we just unfortunately, because we spent so much time at the pool, we never really got around to doing it.
Yeah.
But it is something I'd like to do.
I agree
with you. I think it is enjoyable. I know you've done it. You've done it between Boardwalk and.
Yeah. One night we took it and it was nice because it was a beautiful evening and we were catching it during sunset. So we walked over from the boardwalk, jumped out on the International Gateway, took it all the way over to Caribbean Beach at the transfer station, and then took it over to Hollywood Studios, and then literally got off at Hollywood Studios, went right around the front, got back on, took it back. We stopped at Riviera real quick, and then took it back. It was what a great view.
It is
nice. What a great view. And we were lucky enough because I asked both times to say, hey, listen, can we go on? And it wasn't busy. We were lucky. And the gentleman let me on, just her and I. It was really just nice and relaxing. The vents are open.
Yes.
It was a good time. I really enjoy it. The only thing I don't like is, and it's happened to me several times, is over when you do that turn station.
Yes.
In Boardwalk, and then you start going past the, call it the Hess station.
Or gas station.
There, the gas station, remember the old Hess. And then we stopped over Lake Buena Vista Drive going towards Riviera, and then she just started swinging. Yeah. And I was like, don't move. Don't move. I do not like that. And that is one of my fears in the Skyliner, is being stuck there for an extended period of time.
Well, yeah.
And then thinking about that, there's only a cable holding me up.
Yeah, and you're trying not to go on a windy day. If you go on a windy day, you're going to get that frequently.
Yeah.
So that's not.
And fun. I think it happened to you too. It definitely happened to me before we wrap this segment up.
Yeah.
Watch on the Skyliner, because when those thunderstorms happen in the summer, I went to Riviera. Ah,
yeah.
Got stuck at Riviera. Yeah. They closed the gates as I was coming up to get on, and I was at Boardwalk that time. And then I ended up getting a Uber to then go back to the Boardwalk because I was stuck. I was stranded. There was nowhere to go.
Well, you actually brought up an interesting topic, because that's actually one of my sticking points with the Skyliner. Mm-hmm. They really don't have a backup plan, or not an efficient backup plan for weather issues, because when I experienced that, they shut it down, and then they told us I was at the station over at the Caribbean Beach. And
the transfer station.
The transfer station there, yeah. And we were trying to get back to, I think I was trying to get back to, was it Pop?
Beach and Yacht?
Or maybe it was Beach and Yacht, yeah. And so we were there and it started pouring, and then there was lightning. Well, there really wasn't lightning. It was like 10 miles away, but as you know, it could, 10 miles away, they shut it down. Yeah, it's like it's in lockdown. So now they're like, oh, we're going to get you bus transportation. Okay. Well, 20 minutes goes by. They finally, now I don't know why it would took 20 minutes to get a bus from, you know, an extra bus from, I guess, over by the Magic Kingdom, where they usually have the garage over there, and bringing it over. And then they actually walked us in the pouring rain from that transfer station down that ramp.
I'm sorry.
Okay, you know where the little Joffrey's mud is down there at the bottom of that ramp? Then we banged the left, and the bus was over on that side there. And we got
there's
soaked.
A bus stop over there, right?
Yes, and we got actually, soaked.
Yeah, okay.
We got soaked. And we're like, wait a minute, we just got drenched for no reason when we just could have just waited this out. And they weren't letting you wait, because it wasn't even like they were giving you a choice, like, oh, if you want to stand here underneath the overhang. They were making you move. because they were like, you're going. They were clearing out that entire loading area of the Skyliner. So, again, that's one of those things where, look, I understand the danger of the lightning and all that, obviously, because it is, you know, a gondola system. But there's really no reason for you to – it pours in Florida all the time, like practically every afternoon. So to shut it down for rain – I just think it's kind of like, you know, shut it down for, you know, 15, 20 minutes, half hour. And then when it blows over, just reopen it right away. And that's the other thing. It takes forever to reopen it.
Let's go. I mean, roll the dice. Live a little.
Yeah, I just, you know, I think they need to be a little bit better prepared for those situations. I don't think that the system they have set up is...
especially to have extra busing or something when you know, especially those summer days, you should have buses ready to go.
Plus, they have weather radar. So you have weather, you know when the storm's coming in. So prepare for it. You say, okay, in half an hour, we're going to have a really bad storm. We're going to shut down the Skyliner. Let's have the buses ready to go. So as soon as these people come off, they can get right on a bus. Yeah. Very, very few. There were a few managers around that particular day, and they just seemed like they had no idea what was going on. So,
Did you get a free fast pass? Well, they don't exist.
Yeah, no. Sorry, that wasn't happening. So anyway, so let's talk about one of your favorite DVC places, the Geyser Point Bar and Grill. Just had a cataclysmic menu change where the cheesy barbecue brisket was removed. Now, I've never had the cheesy barbecue brisket, but from my understanding, this was a very, very popular menu item, and it is gone. So, yeah. So I don't, they never really gave a reason why. I understand that they've added some new items, some new menu items recently. Yes. And I think we talked about this on a previous show, and, you know, there's a few, there's like a charcuterie board, I think, that they're adding, and a few other items, but why, any idea on your part why they would have removed the cheesy barbecue brisket?
Like, no, because it was very popular on the menu. I did not ever experience it or order it. I never experienced I never experienced it, but I was with friends and family that have ordered it while I was at Geyser Point, and they enjoyed it immensely. And I do like brisket, but I just didn't sample it. I like my bison burger there. It's arguably, if not the best burger on property, bar none. It's a little shocking. So for something that's that popular, I don't understand their reasoning for the removal. You know what I mean? Well, like, I can understand if it's not selling, it's not selling. Get it off the menu. But this is something that, even if you read other news outlets and articles, this is a popular menu item. So why would you get rid of it? I understand you expanded the menu. Like you said, just to name off a few, they came out with a charcuterie flatbread, turkey BLT sandwich, macaroni and cheese bites, a multi-grain salad with tofu. But sorry for you people out there like tofu. But, and that's just to name a few. And I have seen and I've watched a couple of reviews of the new menu items there. And people liked just about everything. Like, well, the next time, the next trip, and especially if you and I go together, I'm taking you. Once you dine there.
I'd love to go.
Oh my God. It is one of my favorite places to go. You know, especially, I always tell people all the time, if you're going to go to Magic Kingdom, do not waste your money on lunch in Magic Kingdom. Take the water taxi and take a nice ride over to the Wilderness Lodge. It's literally, you get off the boat, you walk up the plank, you bang a left at the pool, and it's literally right there. And you can enjoy one of my favorite resorts.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think, have you noticed a little something going on? Maybe I'm just, you know, reading too much into it. But it seems like there's been a little bit of Disney, and when I say Disney, I mean the actual company itself, Disney hate towards the Wilderness Lodge and Fort Wilderness, where it seems like, you know, like, they're removing things. They're, you know, this kind of leads me into, you know, the cabins. You know, all of a sudden DVC is moving into Fort Wilderness. You know, I don't know. It seems like that area, either the Wilderness Lodge and Fort Wilderness, have a target on their back. You know, that Disney just decided.
Well, I would 100% agree with you. I always mix them up. Fort Wilderness Lodge, because I know, I have read blog after blog, I have seen Facebook pages, I have, you name it, I have read it, and excluding DVC people, the heart and soul, the fans of Fort Wilderness Lodge are not happy. Are not happy that DBZ is at the gates ready to invade. They're not happy. Yeah, you know, you're bougieing up. You're bougieing up the campgrounds. That's what you're doing.
Yeah, yeah, that seems a little strange. Like I just saw a video of the Halloween decorations over at Wilderness Lodge, and that looked
The golf carts.
Yeah, with the golf carts, and that looked really, really cool. And it kind of opened my eyes to how passionate the people are there.
Mm-hmm.
For, I mean, granted, you know, you have to be passionate for Halloween, but not just that. It's just the fact that they're passionate to decorate, because, like I said,
to that extent.
Yeah, and I'm like, wait a minute, you had to lug all of your Halloween stuff to Disney.
To Disney World.
To Disney World.
Load it up, honey. Load it up.
We're not talking just a few decorations. We're talking massive amounts of decorations. Mm-hmm. You know, like the kind of, like, they would put Lowe's to shame. I mean, the amount of stuff they had. And, you know, it just, it's interesting because, like you said, that's a different clientele.
Yes.
Than, and I'm sorry, I know you're a DVC member, but
it's okay.
DVC,
I forgive you.
DVC folks have a little bit of a snootiness to them.
Are you saying we're bougie?
Yeah, you are. I mean, I'm a former DVC member, and I, you know, I can attest to that. But I just think that's just, look, I understand that Disney is trying to expand their DVC footprint into that area, but it seems like they're just displacing those poor people into
Move on, move on.
Like you get out of here, you know? And I don't know. I just think they could have, it's not like they don't have the land, you know, they have plenty of land there. They could have done something else in a different area. If you wanted to build cabins that are, you know, environmentally friendly, which is I from what I've been reading is what they want to do. Nothing wrong with that. But that's not at the top of my list when I go on vacation. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know about you, but I don't.
Same here.
I don't say, like, hey, I wonder if my cabin has solar panels on it. Would I put solar panels on my house to save money and be more efficient? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But I wouldn't. It's not at the top of my list when I go on vacation to say, oh, I wonder if my Fort Wilderness cabin is, you know, energy efficient. I just want to go and relax and unwind. And
I just want to pump the air conditioning.
Yeah, there you go.
that is not environmentally friendly.
No. But it's just I just think that they're taking away something that people obviously it's obviously beloved.
Mm hmm.
And it's just another one of those things where they almost purposefully, I don't want to accuse them of that, but I kind of am, purposefully of doing these things to people. Like, they purposely go out of their way to, like, remove, like, beloved rides and beloved food items. I mean, we just talked about that with, you know.
Damn, you guys are pointing your brisket.
The cheesy brisket. I mean, it just seems like, okay, we're just going to. Yeah. Go out there and take things away from people. And by the way, while we're at it, we're also going to raise your prices. So
you know where that cheesy brisket's going to end up at Fort Wilderness.
Yeah, exactly.
Go get your cheesy brisket down there now.
Yeah, it just doesn't make a lot of sense to me. But so since we've turned the corner here after Halloween. And we're headed now towards what I call Thanksmas, which is a combination.
Yeah, right there. Yeah, there he is, right there. Yeah, the first one. Just like Disney, Walter and I are slowly bringing in Christmas.
Yeah, so we're into Thanksmas now. I there is some news, actually, that the Gingerbread House over at the Grand Floridian has started construction.
Yep.
Have you gotten to see that in person ever?
No, I have not. I have seen it. Under construction,
okay,
but not the finished product.
Okay,
just like you and I talked about before taping today, that my first ever trip with you, I saw the Osborne Light Spectacular display, not on. Mm-hmm. Everything was up. The sign was up. Everything was decorated, but it was in the evening. But I missed it by like 4 days.
Oh, that's just devastating.
And I never got to see it besides on YouTube. And that like haunts me.
Yeah, that is one of my favorite all time, not even just for Christmas, but just all time favorite things at Disney. Like, I would look forward to going there to see that. I experienced it, I think, about three times. Once with my mom.
Lucky you.
On a trip that I went with her. And the first time, I think
that's cool.
She thoroughly enjoyed it. And then there was a couple of times my wife and I went, and the first time we experienced, we said, wow, we got to come back next year to experience this again. And I think of all of the things that they've removed from Disney, and we just talked about this on our previous show, was the Tapestry of Nations parade over at Epcot that I really enjoyed. I think removing the Osborne Family Spectacular was
one of the worst.
It was a dagger in the heart for me, because that was like, you know, it's got to be in my top three or four all time things that I just thoroughly enjoyed. Matter of fact, I just watched a video of it on YouTube just before we started taping, and it just that opening when it first starts, when they're playing that Mannheim Steamroller Christmas music, it just gives you goosebumps. I mean, if you don't get goosebumps from that, then you better check your blood pressure, because it's just awesome. It is one of the best things that they've done in decades. And for them to take it away, listen, I get it. Star Wars Galaxy's Edge was coming around, but you had other opportunities to maybe do something else with that or move it. It went to a good cause. The lights were donated by Disney to Give the Kids the World.
Yes, it was donated.
Yeah, so they do a smaller version of that over there for the kids, and that's great. In Disney itself, I think there was plenty of room that they could have, even if they did like a watered down version of it, if they didn't do the whole thing, to take it away. You know, I that one is a head scratcher. But
I want to know when was the last, Walt? Do you remember? I'm trying to look it up right now as you're talking. I didn't mean
well, it debuted in 1995. I don't remember when the last it would have to be right before the Galaxy's Edge construction started. Yeah. So, you know, that probably didn't that take like 10 years? Everything takes
that did. Know. Oh, so, January 6th of 2016.
Okay.
Was its last performance.
Okay. Yeah. So I didn't
that's what I was trying to look up when you were talking about it.
Yeah. I think the last time I saw it was probably a year or two before then. I unfortunately didn't get there in 2016, right before it closed down.
No, but I did not. And I went like always, like after that, it was 2014, 2015. And then I would always go like in the fall and then.
Yeah.
Early but that in the next year. So
but that gingerbread house that we started talking about, that is. If you've never experienced that, first of all, you have the grandeur of the Grand Floridian's lobby, which is just an amazing lobby to begin with. And then when you add in the Christmas decorations and that Christmas tree, and then you throw in that gingerbread house, which is massive. It's human size. It's, you know, you pointed out earlier about, you know, doing like a resort only where you travel around. That is something worthwhile. I think, didn't you do that a few vacations ago or a few years ago where you visited the Christmas decorations at different resorts? Or am I wrong?
Yes, several years ago. Yes, I did. But it was one of the years of the pandemic, so they did not have the gingerbread houses.
Oh, okay. All right.
So that's where it was. So because they even have, affected by the plague.
Yes.
But the one year I did get the complete set, they actually yearly they make resort pins for the gingerbread houses, the gingerbread collection. And they were really cool. And I got a complete set of them, because once we start buying something like that, my wife was then on a mission. You know, Beth, she was on a mission. We were finding them. Yep. We were going to every resort to get them. So that is something nice. But I so want to check this out for real. I mean, how cool is it that they put this thing together in 2 weeks or less? So you're looking at probably mid-November, the absolute latest.
Yeah.
This will be up and running, completed, functional. They will be selling. You could purchase gingerbread there. I love gingerbread. Love gingerbread cookies.
I love those. Yeah.
I would probably, I got to lose weight, and I would definitely not lose weight there. I'd have my Joffrey's coffee, and I would just stand there.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't even pay for it. I'd just start picking that roof, the shingles off.
Well, that's that way.
Get down on the ground.
Yeah, you'd get trespassed really fast, I think.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. If you're going to get trespassed at Disney, you want to do it, have it worthwhile, not like stealing shingles off the gingerbread house. Because that's just not going to
get you. See me in all the outlets. Yeah. This guy from New Jersey was arrested drinking a Joffrey's coffee and stealing shingles off the gingerbread house.
Yeah, you're not going to get street cred with that scenario. So
no, I'll get a lot of hate mail.
Yeah. But you're right. It's a massive amount of work, and they, the chefs over there do a great job of putting that together. It's so much detail that goes into it, and you could tell how much love and care that they, enjoy doing that year after year. And it is, like you said, it is worth definitely stopping by, to visit. Speaking of one other topic here that involves some after hours news that came out recently. So Disney announced that starting in January, January 11th, actually, to be specific, through April the 8th, they are doing extra magic hour events. Now, you know that is not something, it's something that irritates me. Because as we've talked about this in the past, this was free. Okay.
Yep.
You had extra magic hours multiple times a week at different parks. You alternated parks. You got an extra 3 hours as a benefit to the consumer, to the park hold, the person, who's going to these parks.
Yeah.
And now you're charging, and this is significant. I mean, you're talking at Magic Kingdom, it's $155 to $175, depending on the dates. And Epcot is a little less at $149 to $159. You're getting basically 3 hours is what you're getting. So the hours alternate a little. Like at Hollywood Studios, it's 9:30 to 12:30. Magic Kingdom, it's 10 to 1. Epcot,
I like the 1 o'clock.
Yeah, I used to love the late night hours. My wife and I, the latest I've ever been in Magic Kingdom was 3 a.m. There was one trip where we left. I actually worked all day. We caught a late afternoon flight out of New Jersey. We landed in Orlando probably around dinner time. Went and had dinner at the resort I checked into, and then went to Magic Kingdom and still spent close to 6 hours from around, I think it was maybe, I think we got in there around 9 o'clock. And when think, oh God, and your God, you're starting your park day at 9 o'clock at night, and we didn't get out of there. We closed the park at 3 a.m. And now granted, I was exhausted. But it was so much fun because it was worth it because you got to experience a different time, no crowds. By like 2 a.m., you were getting on Peter Pan. You were literally walking off Peter Pan and getting back on Peter Pan.
Yeah, there was nobody there.
There was no one there. We were on Big Thunder Mountain where they actually let you stay on. They didn't make you get off. The train.
I've had that once on Big Thunder, actually.
Yeah, where they just said, "Yeah, you want to go around again? Yeah, okay, just stay on." You didn't even have to get off.
Do you know what sucked that happened to me? I was on Big Thunder, and they put me in the last cart.
Oh.
And then they're like, "Oh, stay on if you want to go again." And Beth's like, "You're not getting up." And I'm like, "It is god awful in the last row of Big Thunder. It beats the crap out of you."
It does jar you.
What a difference between the middle of the front and that last. Oh my God.
The only thing worse than that is Space Mountain to jerk you around and, you know, just mess your back up. But that, it was just so much fun to be able to do that. And now, like you said, now it's 1 a.m., you know, which is still nice.
Yeah.
But you're also paying $150 to $175 to do this.
Yes.
And here's the thing, and we've talked about this many times. We complain about the price point, and we say, wow, that's a lot. But they sell out. People still go.
They sell out.
And here's the thing. People don't realize it, when they sell out of these events, yes, the crowds are reduced from what they are at their peak during the daytime.
Correct.
But it's still crowded. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get – you paid $155. You think, oh, I'm going to get on all these rides. You may not. You might still have to wait a half hour to 40 minutes sometimes, if not longer, for some of these popular rides, and it's still pretty crowded.
Yeah, because you're still getting crowds like for like a Mickey's Not So Scary, a Mickey's Very Merry. It's just like them.
Right. It doesn't start to – the crowds don't thin out until very, very late at night. So usually if a park is open, like for example with Magic Kingdom, it's open until 1 a.m., you're probably going to get – by midnight, you're going to get it to thin out a little bit.
Yeah.
But when it first, when you first get there at 7, 8 o'clock, you're still battling.
You have that transition too.
Right. You're still battling the regular park, you know, goers during the day. And then on top of that, you have all these, the influx of all of the people who are at this event. And of course, what do? They're going to go crowd into all the popular rides.
Yes.
So you're going to still have long lines at these events. So a lot of people are under the misimpression that they think, oh, we're gonna just walk right into you know, Peter Pan. You're gonna probably still wait 35-40 minutes. I mean, yes, it's less than what you will during the day, but you're not gonna, a lot of these rides, you're gonna ride them once. And honestly, for that price point, I don't really know if it's worth it, because you can get into the park for less than that and be there all day. And yes, you're going to be dealing with crowds, but you know, it's a little bit different.
Well, I remember the one night, do you remember, and we probably told the story before, but it was one of the first times you and I went together and we went to Magic Kingdom. We actually was kind of like what your story. We flew in later in the evening. We actually, the first dinner I had was at ESPN on the boardwalk.
Yes.
And then we went over to Magic Kingdom for Extra Magic, and it was either 2 or 3 in the morning. And I remember getting me on Pirates, and that was the first time I rode it, and there wasn't a soul in front of us. So then we get on the ride, and like I'm trying, and I have said this because I am a chicken. Back then, I was really bad. I was like, oh my God, I don't know where this ride's going to go. And right when you're taking your picture, you could hear the whoo of the boat running. I'm like, oh my God, oh my God. I just start panicking, and we took that dip. I was like, you guys tricked me, you didn't tell me.
Yeah, I thought you were gonna bail out of the boat.
Oh my god. And then you couldn't, to top it off, you couldn't even see it. I was like in a pitch black, and then like all of a sudden there's a boat there, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'm good now.
And there's Barbossa up there. Well, back then there was no Barbossa.
Yeah. Do you remember when we were leaving? There was only maybe 20 of us on the ferry, and the captain smacked into the post and the piers. Oh my God. You and I were standing there on the side. Beth and Kendall were sitting down, and you're like, yeah, we're going to hit. You know, we're like looking. I'm like, oh yeah. I was like, no, he's going to turn. No, we're going to hit. And man, that ship whaled it.
Was that the Joe Potter? I think.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Coming back over to the TTC. Boom.
Yeah, they barrel right into that stanchion there. Yeah. The loading dock. They hit it pretty hard.
That was good. We got nothing. No free fast pass, no nothing. Then he come out of the captain's quarters. Have a good night, everybody. It's like, oh, get off. This guy wants to go home.
As the ferry starts to sink because it took on some water.
Oh my God.
You know, before we wrap up the show, I had an idea of something that I wanted to get your thoughts on it, Ken, and see what you think. I thought about, you know, Disney obviously loves to have extra events, you know, whether it's, food festivals or, you know, now after hours events.
Yeah.
And you and I always talk about things that we miss. So how about if they had, what do you think about nostalgia weekends? So you have like weekends during the year, you know, they could pick dates the same way they do, say, for example, like with Moonlight Magic. Yeah. And have a nostalgia weekend where they bring back either food that's been gone or a ride.
Characters.
You know, characters, a parade, fireworks, some sort of, you know, like, for example, now there, we talked about this on a previous episode with Epcot, where with Soarin', they brought back the Soarin' Over California. So that's an example of something that, you know, you have nostalgia weekend where you bring back a ride that you, now you can't bring back rides that you completely destroyed. So like you can't bring back the Great Movie Ride, which would be nice. But like, you know, like a fireworks show, or like you said, maybe some characters or a dining, some sort of, you know, like the cheesy barbecue brisket, for example.
Yeah, there it is.
But I mean, what do you think about that? Having like nostalgia weekends where, you know, you bring back something that's been gone for a while. You think that would be popular with people?
I think it would be cool. Like, even if you did, I think, like you said, it had to be at least several weeks, because, you know, to put the money into it of what they're going to have to do, from the advertisement to, like, whether it's a fireworks show, whether it's getting stuff and costumes for the parades again, stuff like that. I'm all for it because, like, I'm a history buff. So I like that, and I like to be able to get something that I missed out on years ago, whether I just missed it or I wasn't a fan then, I wasn't going to Disney World then. Like, one thing I thought they did pretty well was during the 50th, they had that vault collection where they brought back the memorabilia, the original Disney World logo and stuff like that from when it first opened in 71. I was like, wow, this is cool. Like, really cool to be able to pick up the sweatshirt, the t-shirt, the mug, stuff like that. You know, even like, you know, back when we were kids, the bumper stickers you put on the car, like, it was all like so cool. And that's one thing I think they hit out of the park with the 50th was the vault collection. Mm-hmm. And actually, from what I heard, I don't know how true it is, our favorite person in the whole wide world, why can't I think of his name? The former CEO. That was his idea, I heard.
Oh, Mr. Chapek?
Mr. Chapek. I heard that was his idea. I'm not 100%, but I heard. So if it was, bravo on that move.
So he had one good idea his entire tenure.
He had one good idea. Because that's why he was counting the shillings after. He was like, oh, yeah, look how much money we made.
Well, you bring up a good point, because they love to ring the register on everything. Mm-hmm. And if you're bringing back, whether it be, you know, memorabilia or, you know, anything that is something that they're going to sell, you know, on their, you know, website, I'm sure people would be interested in that. I just thought of that. I said, you know, it would be interesting if they, like you said, it would have to be, you know, for at least say a month, but just don't do it every day. You know, if you just did it on the weekends, just to get people in there. Not that, you know, it's slow on the weekends, but you're getting my drift. It's just, it's one of those things where, it's almost like they're afraid to acknowledge that they've taken stuff away that was popular, and don't be afraid to bring it back and say, hey, you know what? We respect the fan base, and we want to bring some of these things back, and we know you really enjoyed it, but unfortunately we had to move on from these things for whatever reasons, whether it was, you know, time to expand a park or whatever, bring in something new, but at least acknowledge that, hey, we know that you love this and we're going to respect it and bring it back for a period of time. And oh, and by the way, we're going to also charge you for it too. Yeah. So, you know, cause that's what we do.
Yeah.
You know,
but Walt, one thing I've always liked with the after hours events, Moonlight Magic, is that they bring special characters out that they normally don't have. And I'm not a big character guy, but it is nice to see a character that, like, we may have grew up with that you don't normally see in the parks. And then they bring it in for special events. Like, I am a huge Oswald guy. Mm-hmm. Oswald appears time to time in Disneyland, but he's almost never, I've never seen him at any after hours events. I could have missed him. Maybe I wasn't at it, but like, that's like one character that'd be cool to take a picture with for me. I like Oswald. I like the character. Yeah. So that like something right there, like, okay, Disney World normally doesn't get Oswald, like bring Oswald back for a limited time. Like you put him on the annual pass magnet that I'm missing out on. Damn you, Walt Disney World. Yeah. So something like that. Like that would interest me and that would draw me to go. Like I just wanted to go just because of the magnet.
Right. So that
doesn't take much to get me to want to go. So I was like, oh, magnet, I'll fly 900 miles. Let's go.
Yeah, so imagine what you would do for Oswald. I mean, geez.
Exactly. Yeah. See, but I love the idea. But
all right, here
I think the creativity is still there because you see what they're
doing. Would you get on Tron to meet Oswald?
No, that was a quick. That was a hard no. No.
Wow, so much for that, huh?
Take that, Oswald. But in closing, Walt, you, I am still a believer that imagination, the Imagineers. Still have the talent because you see what they're doing overseas with their rides and their parks. They're doing phenomenal work. Granted, they have a little different over there because some of those parks are also partially funded by the government. Mm-hmm. So Disney's not footing 100% of the bill as they are here in Disneyland and Disney World. So that's why I also think you don't see some of those projects here because they have to pay 100% of the cost here, but correct. So they still have the people to do it. It's just, they don't want to spend the money here. And guess what? They don't have to, like you said, the after hours events sell out. Mickey's Not So Scary. Mickey's Very Merry. You know, that's the next one. Sold out. So they don't have to.
Yeah.
When stuff doesn't start selling out and people stop showing up to certain things, that's when they will change. That's it.
And that hasn't happened, and I don't foresee that happening. Yeah, you know, because we've been kind of expecting that shoe to drop for quite a long time, and it never came. So,
and yes, and we've said it. Like, when is it going to hit its point? And it hasn't.
No,
it hasn't.
Yeah, it's like almost like like football season tickets. Like you're in the New York area. The New York teams, no matter how bad they are, year after year, they have a waiting list for season ticket holders. Yeah. And the Disney's the same, because if as many disgruntled people that have left, there's always somebody who's going to step over them and they'll step
right on you and go get their pass
and take their place. So and Disney knows that. That's why they've continued to move forward with these events where everything, you don't see anything going back. You've seen things come back from pre-COVID, but you haven't seen them come back for without a price tag attached to them.
Yes.
There's very little is free. That's free anymore. There's
free parking.
You could count it on one hand. So other than that, you know, everything else has gotten a price tag attached to it. Sure. And
with increases every year.
Increases, and people still pay them and people still go. You know, so it's the way of the world, man. We can't, you got to, sometimes you just, you know,
you're ready to mortgage everything to go see the mouse.
Yeah. You make your decisions and you live with them. And then some people want to do it. And some people don't, you know, it's the way of the world.
And that's totally up to them. You do you, like you say, you do you.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I haven't coined that. I can't take credit for that phrase. That was a very special guest that we had on our show who loves to use that phrase.
Yes. So that's her. But I like it. Just do you. Whatever makes you happy, you do it.
Absolutely. Well, Ken, I think we're going to wrap it up here. Another fun show.
Yep. Had a lot of fun. Thank you very much.
Yeah. And please, before you leave, please don't forget to take your mask off. Okay.
You know what? I should have took it off when you told me in the beginning. I forgot.
I got you. I had to get you again. You
threw me off, and now I had to go, 49 minutes with the mask on? Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to hear it.
So. Well, have a good night.
Yeah, you too. All right, folks, that's going to wrap up this edition of the Disney Resorts Podcast. We hope you enjoyed it. For Walt Ramirez, I'm Kenny Hayes. Take care, everybody.